Hi! Oh, how wonderful to be here. My name is Jonny Woo, as thank you very much, as the introduction was given, and here we are. You know, so this is my opening outfit. And the opening is over, so I think we lose the outfit, don't we? I think that's what you do. Before I did this, you know, tonight, I was thinking, I really hate learning lines. It's really kind of, it's my kind of the worst thing that I do in my job is having to learn lines. I have a little script in my little Chanel bag. Let's see if I stick to it or if I deviate. Excuse me. I'll stop saying excuse me. I just have to accept that that's just the way it is. That's just the way it is. Okay, so I don't know, the wig. I wasn't sure. The wig, are we feeling the wig? That's all right, isn't it? I think it looks natural. I think I could get away with it. I have actually convinced myself that I can get away with kind of wearing wigs like this. I haven't yet started wearing these wigs out and about as a man in kind of normal day wear. They might look a little bit weird. I don't think there's anything wrong with looking a little bit weird, but joking. I don't know. Some people think it's a little bit David Bowie. Yeah. Anne Robinson? I don't know. It's a bit Anne Robinson, isn't it? Anyway, so this is it. This is me. And there are some legs, and I'm just gonna, you know, we're just gonna see what happens. My chair hasn't been set, if I can get my chair. So basically, I'm Jonny Woo, and to all intents and purposes, I am a drag queen. It's taken me a long time to make that admission, weirdly enough, because I've been doing it for a long time. And you'll see some of the reasons why that may have happened, but I'm quite happy to embrace that term now. Thank you very much. I never started off wanting to be a drag queen. It wasn't my intention. I didn't start out in life thinking, wow, I want to go into drag. Yes, as a gay man, I kind of flirted around in my mum's wardrobe and put a bit of a makeup on and that kind of stuff. But, you know, I was never thinking I want to be a drag queen. I wanted to go into musical theatre. So I became a drag queen. That doesn't mean I failed, by the way. When I was three, my sister kind of dressed me up in my mum's clothes and kind of like presented me to my mum. You know, when I was three in the kitchen, I said, oh, look, it's the new girl from next door. You know, I didn't find this a joyful experience. My mum kind of said, Jonathan, if I'd wanted another little girl, I'd have had another little girl. That wouldn't have happened, would it? You can't, you know, if I'd have known, mum, that wouldn't happen. And then, you know, we did shows for my nan. We kind of, I don't know if you all did shows for your grandparents when you were kids, and we used to dress up, and I don't always remember choosing the lady role, as it were. I do remember once using my nan's hemorrhoid ring as a hat, and she was mortified. That mortified her. I didn't know what it was. I can remember that. When I was 12 years old, I used to spend hours in front of the bathroom mirror with piling towels on my head in all these kind of eccentric like styles. My dad thought I was doing something else in the bathroom, but it was just very innocent, kind of like towel kind of like piling. But I had no desire to be a drag queen at that point. And when it was my mum's 50th birthday, and I can't, you know, when my mum's 50th birthday, which was a fancy dress party, me and Angela decided to dress as my mum and my dad. I didn't opt to dress as my mum, I dressed as my dad. But we used those towels to pat out Angela's hips because she was dressing as my mum, and my mum wasn't happy again. At a boat party. Maybe my history of drag is just like pissing off my mum. Probably is now. She has seen some of the things I get at times. It took a while. And the moment when I wasn't going to let her do it, and the moment she actually actually saw me kind of like wearing something like this was in the middle of Selfridges on a Saturday afternoon. When I was, I'll hold back on the knicker though. And then she came over, my mum and dad came in early. Anyway, no, I'm not going to tell you about that, you can just use your imagination. At a boat party at university. It was a fancy-dressed boat party, I didn't do drag, I dressed up. I dressed up as my favourite ecstasy tablet. I'm obsessed. Dressed as a snowball. Does anyone remember snowball ecstasy tablets? Of course you don't, because if you did, then you've got no memory. Anyway, so, you know, so by my mid-twenties, this is the wonderful thing. Every time I kind of finish the thing, I toss that away, and my heart kind of like relaxes a little bit more. By my mid-twenties, I was a little bit camp, but I didn't want to be a drag queen. I just did lots of drugs. Drag? I did do lots of drugs. It's part of the story, actually. It is part of the story. Drag, for me, was the corner of a pub in the midweek. It was misogyny, British drag, tacky drag, it was called when I was living in Birmingham. It was tacky drag, it was like loads of like fake pubes coming out your knickers and kind of like weird hairy armpits and fish gags and fanny gags and cock jokes and stuff like that. It was misogyny, essentially, a lot of it was. And I didn't really like it, and you kind of enjoyed it and kind of laughed along when you're really, really pissed. And also, the other thing which kind of put me off the idea of being a drag queen at the time was because all drag queens out of drag all had shaved eyebrows, plucked eyebrows and shaved armpits, and you know, there was a little bit of butch in me. I went to New York in 1999. This was the big turning point. In 1999, I went to New York to be a dancer. I was like Madonna. She went to New York to be a dancer, and she left a pop star. I left a drag queen. I don't know quite what went wrong, but I'm secretly hoping that my career might be like a reverse of Madonna's career. And as Madonna has went to become a dancer, then became a pop star, and then morphed into a drag queen, I'm kind of hoping dancer, drag queen, pop star. I don't know, maybe. There you go, another heartbeat. Okay. So this notion of drag, what did I discover? Okay, living in New York, my friends were essentially, quickly, they were either drag queens or strippers. Hence no clothes. But they were not strippers, really. You know, the term burlesque was being bandied around. And on a way, this was downtown, the downtown performance art scene, you know, burlesque dancers. On a Wednesday night, my friend Catherine, who I lived with, she would be channeling the white lady and exploring her feminist agenda, and for the rest of the week she was uptown at the Pussycat Lounge turning tricks for Wall Street Boys. So, drag queens and strippers, and she was a dancer too. I'm not sure if she's still a stripper. I think she's gone. I think she dances with her clothes on now. But, you know, I spent a lot of time with a lot less on than this. We'll kind of get into that in just a minute. So, but the bottom line is, drag for me, when I first experienced it, drag was just fun. I wasn't even thinking about it. I wasn't thinking about whether it was drag or not. In New York, there was a permission amongst the downtown scene for me to be an artist. I'd never kind of experienced that. You know, if you dressed up and did stuff, you know, it was art, it was fun, it was kind of like doing something exciting. You know, me and my friend Brandon Olson, who is a wonderful performance artist in New York, you know, we'd just dress up in a kind of like middle of the day or something, or kind of any day of the week. I lived in a thrift store on Avenue A and 9th Street, and we'd put on ball gowns, we'd put on we'd put masks on our head, we'd put on, we wrapped ourselves up in sheets when we went down to the West Village, and we had enemas on our head, and we gave ourselves little red marks all over our body, and we went down and terrorized the muscle queens in the West Village. For me, at that time, let's lose that for now, for me, at that time, drag was about having a good time. My makeup was all over the place, Brandon's was immaculate, but there were always the high heels. I was often in just a, you know, a jockstrap and nothing else. Of course, I was English, I was in New York, everybody else was sober, I was completely pissed. But also what happened here, which I'd never experienced before, there was a community amongst the drag queens and the burlesque dancers and the performance artists. And, you know, we used to go and see Sweetie in the, on a Sunday night with my friend Lavinia Cobb, who's this amazing British drag queen from a comedy called The Blue Lips. We'd get drunk, we'd hug, and we'd have a wonderful, wonderful time. Anyway, so there was the politic going on. I had this thing about the muscle queens on the west side. It was the 90s, and it was happening here as well. The muscle queens, there was a body fascism, so I thought. It was exclusive. It wasn't about kind of experiencing and being welcoming to gay people. So this running around with the makeup all spewed over my face with nothing on, there was a bit of like an underlying politic going on as well. Also, this community really kind of came through after 9/11, for example. People were like, we had a show booked on the Saturday night, and no one really knew what was going to happen. But we went back down to this Sunday night club, and we sat there counting our friends, even though we knew that they probably weren't involved in what happens, but there was that sense. And Justin Bond, the leading alternative drag queen at the time, sang to us and comforted us, and it was a really, really beautiful moment. My last really kind of lasting memory of doing drag in New York was running through the streets in the middle of winter, dressed in gold peep-toe shoes, a gold bikini, a mink fur hat from a thrift store, running to catch Amanda Lepore in a party that Brandon was throwing in a shop in the, down at the East Side. She was sitting there naked on a gold throne, hosting, doing absolutely nothing. Okay, so that's it. So much joy, but also, I'll admit it, so much self-destruction, and I decided to bring that back to London and experiment with that. And I decided to start throwing parties in a pub called the Georgian Dragon. The party was called Radio Egypt, and I did it with a dear friend of mine called Richardette, who was a Bucks Fizz aficionado. And my aim of the party was basically to go as wild as possible and give people, other people, the permission to go wild as well. The drag at this time was about making people say, what the fuck is going on? What the hell is he doing with those boxing gloves? Giving people the experience of, you know, kind of like breaking down and going completely mad. And I'll admit, it was completely drug-fueled and nihilistic and very, very alcoholic. But people absolutely loved it. And for me, the ego had landed. I believed that I was going to be plucked out of obscurity and dressed like this. I was going to be made a star on your television sets. My sense of the mainstream at this point was a little bit askew. Anyway, so, people coming. New friends were coming. I met a new friend, this guy called John Sizzle. Someone else called Beverly Whispers. I had a friend called Miss Texas. And another friend called Jeanette. Everyone just making up names, getting on the ball with it. After Radio Egypt, we started a night called Tranny Lip Syncing at a bar called Bistrotech, which was a... Did someone go to Tranny Lip Syncing at Bistrotech, or was that just Cheerios? You did, I'll take you over there, Mark. I'm going to stop briefly and explain this word tranny, which I don't know if you know, has had a lot of kind of like social media kind of like storm about it at the moment, because the transsexual community have decided, well, have rightly decided if they want, that it's a kind of like a negative word. At the time, we identified more as transvestites. We didn't identify with the old school drag queens, as I said, which we found to be misogynist and heavy and negative. We liked fashion. We liked the dialogue between the inner female and the male. And hence we used that word. But from this point on, I'm not going to use the word because in public discourse, it is now regarded as being offensive. Then you learn something. Anyway, so, the name of my gang was the House of Egypt. And we were inspired at this time also by a film called Paris is Burning. I don't know if anyone's seen it. And basically they have these balls in America and, you know, and people compete in a runway style. Basically, this was kind of what really caught our imagination, and our scene, the alternative drag scene, the alt drag scene, really jumped onto this, and the kind of like the apex of this was our ball at the Royal Opera House. What is more fun? I challenge you. What is more fun than strutting up and down a catwalk in a pair of 6-inch high heels, pretending to be your favorite supermodel, cheered on by the baying crowd? Nothing can be more fun, does it? Could I have 3 volunteers to come up on stage and help me demonstrate? Come on, John. Come on, come on. Come on. Come on, come on. Come on. Mark, you'll do it, you'll do it, Mark. You'll do it. Now, come at it, come at it. Come at it, come on, that's it, in your own time. But not that time. So if you swiftly go over there, take your shoes off, and pop these shoes on. There you go, just like that, come on, we're just gonna have fun. We're getting involved, this is a lost lecture, this isn't about sitting down. Do you wanna come and join? Come on, let's go, you come and join, you've been sitting there smiling away, come on. Should we start the music while this is happening? You've got to pop these on. You've got flip-flops on or something like that anyway. You know, it's the summer, I'll allow you this. Go down there, where Mark is. Do I have one more person who wants to come and join in? Join in? You've got your shoes off. Come on, you're perfect. Perfect, that's it. You come up here. So first up we've got Mark as Nadia Alman. Okay, there you go. Yeah. You're gonna all go home and kind of be running up and down in kind of each other's shoes. Anyway, so what I'm trying to take you into here is this notion that what we're experiencing is that my kind of notion and the notion that we're kind of exploring is that drag is for everybody and it's deconstructed and it's fun and it's not about kind of misogyny and it wasn't about kind of like downing women. It was about kind of like gay guys enjoying kind of like their femininity and being queer and being exciting and being a community at the same time, which is really important. Gay bingo is probably gay. Should I say that again? Gay bingo is probably the party for which I'm best known for. People say to me, what is gay bingo? And you know what? I don't really have an answer for that. We played bingo and basically threw in all the kind of like madness that we had going on. And it was basically where the concept of alternative to drag really all came together. And myself and friends from when we were doing Raid of Egypt, John Sizzle, and another friend called Mar Butcher, who had a little pig nose. We were kind of the team and We did it in this place called the T-Bar, and it was kind of basically a concrete warehouse bar where we could throw anything at it and it was basically indestructible. For example, fake blood. Halloween, skulking around, I had layers of gothic drag. Throughout the night, a layer would come off with each game, with each number. By the end of the night, ooh, by some kind of like strange coincidence, I was completely naked. I covered myself in fake blood. The effect, everybody started getting off with each other. I don't know why. Paint! Paint was everywhere. I don't know, we had themes. The theme this month was the planets. And we kind of finished off in the finale with by playing the planet's whole suite. And I decided that I was going to be the Earth. I don't know how it happened, but in a watery finale, oh, my clothes fell off. I covered myself with blue paint and spent the next 3 days trying to get it off. The snow! It was snowing! The theme, Christmas. Why not? I decided it would be really good fun if I become a Christmas tree. No, not Christmas tree, a snowman. And so what I did, throughout the course of the evening, all my clothes fell off. I rubbed myself in vegetable fur, rolled around in fake snow, and there is actually, this is the reason why this is actually kind of, this is the only slide we got on, because I think your imagination works better than the actual pictures, because when you actually see the pictures, you'll be like, oh, is that it? And yes, basically, I look like an anemic sausage with an acorn-sized penis. So about that. Everything was going on. The kind of like, the finale of a gay bingo was the number 69. Where I would come down into the audience. A terrified audience. I would approach someone of my fancy, nice gentleman here. I would take them onto the stage with me. I would strip them down to their underpants. I would strip down too. And then lightly put my head down their pants and we'd pretend we're doing a number 69. We're not going to do that now. We're not going to do that now, but I wanted to give you a little bit of feeling what it's like. Be kind of egging me, egging him on to go. We did a modification, but I'll introduce you to the modification. At the end. Anyway, so this was my take on drag. The drag wasn't pretty, it was spectacular, it was broken down, it was nihilistic. You know, there was a lot of drink going on. There was a lot of drugs going on. I'm not going to lie to you. I'm not going to say, wow, look at this. Aren't we having a fabulous time? And no damage was being done. People told me it was genius. I believed that this was genius, you know, fucking ego out of control. TV company actually approached me and offered me a TV contract. What did I do? I imploded, went on a drug spender, and landed up in intensive care. I'm telling you this, you know, not for sympathy, but because it's true. And that's what happened. The whole show had all about deconstruction, and then the biggest show of all, I actually deconstructed. And coming out of it, it was weird. You'd think, okay, what's he gonna learn his lesson? He's gonna give it all up, he's not gonna do the drink and the drugs. I didn't. I was desperate to get back on that horse. And I'll be honest, it's taken me 8 years to get to the point now where I'm able to put the drink and drugs aside and just work on the art and go ahead and kind of be a performer free from all of that. So anyway, there's where I am now. I get that in the fucking meeting, babes. But I'm anonymous. Anyway. I've done a whole show of that in Edinburgh, kind of like, and so blah blah blah. Anyway, so thank you, Homage and Hospital. Okay, so that was it. This is kind of the bit when I was at home, kind of doing my things, and kind of like when I get 3/4 of the way through, I kind of get bored of myself, and so I'm just kind of like. Anyway, so that aside. I did come out and we did carry on and I did have half an eye on kind of like my madness. The next big thing that we did where we really kind of got people together was going to Glastonbury. Weirdly enough, my friends actually came to see me whilst I was in my hospital bed, even though I had this kind of big drink and drugs breakdown, and said to me, Jonny, we're going to Glastonbury, we'd love for you to come and kind of like front the big gate in there. What the fuck was that all about? What was going on? Oh my god, I need a wig. I can't believe it. I forgot to put my wig. Anyway, so we went to Glastonbury, and this is kind of like, This is kind of like when everything came together. We had an East London scene, we had an alternative drag scene, we had a sort of dysfunctional kind of family, community, call you one, bunch of reprobates who used to love just going out, dressing up, coming together and performing. We went to Glastonbury, we were the first gay tent to actually happen at Glastonbury. We were running around in the mud in our lingerie, in our knickers. We were going up to the stone circle, kind of like boozy and kind of tired from dancing all night. We sat there, kind of like in the mud, with the rain just about to come down, while our dear friend, Pia, sat on top of a rock, completely nude. We were always nude, completely nude, except for a bit of gaffer tape on her tits, praying for the sun to come out, and we were going, Pia, 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 Pia. And by some weird coincidence, the sun did come out, and we kind of like thought she was the goddess, but she wasn't really. I think it was just a change in the weather. Anyway, the rest basically is kind of just, you know, history really. It just kind of carried on. What I'm trying to tell you is that a community had come about. I kind of started off, I kind of got these ideas, and I'd come back and I kind of placed myself in the middle of the storm. And I was kind of blind to the fact that whilst I was kind of like cultivating Planet Woo, what I was actually cultivating was a really, really beautiful scene that was growing and is still really, really vibrant today. And I'm pleased and I'm happy to say that I am a drag queen and I'm part of this scene, and I'm happy that I've contributed to something which is really making a significant impact on the city. Would a gentleman for the audience like to join me for the finale, which is how we did dinner? Whose birthday is it? Oh, is it your birthday? Oh, come on, you're in it. Oh, come on, you know you like it. Good. A round of applause. What's your name, my darling? What's your name? Ed. Take them off. I would not say things like that. You sit yourself down there. What's your name? What's that, Jack? Jake, you're going to really regret doing this. I'm not doing this. You're going to be like, God, I wish I'd gone off the stage and done that. Do you know what these are? Jazz hands. Okay, let me just kind of work this out. Oh, that's it, I come there. Yeah, just sit back, and if you put your knees and feet flat like that, hands by your side. And I'll start, let's just leave everything where it is, and go!
Meine Damen und Herren, Mesdames et Messieurs, Ladies und Gentlemen, I give you the international sensation, Fräulein Sally Bowles!
You have to understand the way I am, mine head. A tiger is a tiger, not a lamb, mine head. You'll never turn the vinegar to jam, mine head. So I do what I do. When I'm through, then I'm through. And I'm through to live by my meter. Well, my meter.
It's your birthday now, baby.
Up there, but now it's over. And though I used to care, I need the open air. You're better off without me, my hair. Don't have your eye, my hair, or wonder why my hair. I've always said that I was so over. You mustn't make so proud. You should have known by now. You've every cause to doubt me, my hair. The continent of Europe is so wide, my hair. Not only up and down, but side by side, my hair. I couldn't ever cross it if I'd tried, my hair. But I do what I can, inch by inch, step by step, mile by mile, man by man. use to care. I'm the old man, you're better off without my hair. Don't have your eye, my hair. Oh, wonder why my hair. I've always said that I was older. You mustn't admit you're proud. You should have known by now. You'd every cause to doubt me, my hair. Bye-bye, my number.
Really lovely. Thank you for having me.